Hello, hello. Getting to be about time to start this meeting. Need a very large gavel. Welcome to all of you. I'm Tom Kinzer, the president of the Historical Society. I'd like to welcome you to this meeting, which for one thing is one of our members' meetings with the speaker, and that'll be Sharon McDonald a little bit later. And on the other hand, is partly a business meeting, since it is the Society's annual business meeting. So we have today a meeting with an embedded business meeting, and I will now declare both of them open for business. I'd like to thank the people who are helping us put this together today, our greeters, Sharon McDonald and Lee Vorderer, our setup crew, Carol Amick and Bill Moonen, with some assistance today from Kara Kerwin. And the setup today was a bigger deal than it normally is, for reasons which I'm not in a position to go through, but some of you will hear more about them when we have a discussion at the board meeting about the matter. I'd also like to thank the people who baked or supplied our food and refreshments here: Eleonora Del Federico, Lee Vorderer, Kathy Shopkin, and Carol Amick. And I'd like to thank our videographer, Arwen, from Bedford TV, who has now been with us for, I believe it's three consecutive meetings at least. More than that? Maybe more than that. I'm going to give you a very brief summary of, since this is a business meeting, I need to give you a very brief summary of the minutes from last year's annual meeting. We are not going to try to read the minutes because it would be far too time consuming and they are far too detailed. It just recounts some of the changes that we had undergone, some of the programs that we had summarized, that we had presented to our membership over the years, the fact that we had just completed our move from the back of the police station into our new quarters downstairs on the ground floor here, and the fact that we had embarked upon a new project to rewrite the Society's bylaws, the project which turned out to be quite an undertaking. We also did some elections for people last year. Under the prior bylaws, both the board of directors and the society's officers were elected by the members at these annual meetings. We'll get to the board of directors later, but last year, I was elected president, Paul Percher as vice president, Lee Vorderer as secretary or clerk, and Jan Humphreys as treasurer. This year, it will not work that way because we will be working under the new bylaws under which the directors select the officers rather than the membership. And there are some reasons related to corporate governance why that makes sense. There were elections of board members. Kara Kerwin and Sharon McDonald were elected for new terms. Jane Popper, whose term had expired, was nominated from the floor to a three-year term on the board. And one vacancy was left over. Carol will deal with the rest of all that in a few minutes. So the first thing I'd like to do is ask for a motion to accept the minutes of that meeting as briefly summarized here.
So moved.
Second? It's been moved and seconded. All members in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, no. It being unanimous, I declare the minutes for the last annual meeting adopted. Now this time, we are going to be voting for one thing on directors, and we'll be doing that as well under the new bylaws. Those bylaws were adopted by this group at the last business meeting we had, which was back in March. So I'm going to ask Lee to come up and provide some brief minutes for that meeting, and we'll adopt those as well.
All right. I'm going to spare you my reading of everything that we did at that meeting, but essentially, as Tom suggested, we got together to talk about the importance of new bylaws for the society. Tom went through the detail of what those changes were, and you all agreed. So, if you are willing to accept that three-sentence summary as the report, I would ask for a motion to accept the report from the March tiny little business meeting on the bylaws. Thank you. And second? Thank you. And can we vote? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You're a good group. Thank you. Thank you.
I want to talk a little bit about this last year that we've just been through. We've talked about the bylaws, which got rewritten over and over again, multiple times by a very hardworking bylaws committee. If you've ever tried to organize a bylaws committee, you might have noticed that the stampede of volunteers to serve on that committee did not provide much of a threat to public health or safety. The group running in the other direction might have, but we did it, and it was a good piece of work. We also went through the exercise of accepting an RFP from the town to allow the society to lease this room from the town. We went through two sets of lease negotiations over two sets of lease documents before we finally got the one that we could sign in November. That process lasted from approximately the 1st of June until approximately the last day of November, which was extraordinarily, I thought, excessive, long, and contorted, but it happened. Since then, we have begun the process of deciding how to start doing museum exhibits and working toward that. We have gone through the process of trying to understand how to rent out the space and manage that process. That's certainly underway. We're planning for this year's version of the visit by the fifth graders and the walk for Town of Bedford walk. The people who attend the day of the cultural district this year. We're looking forward to Bedford Day and trying to organize that. And if any of you would like to volunteer to help us with Bedford Day, please feel free to do so. We'd love to have you. We've also made a lot of progress in terms of archival work and recataloging and so forth, and re-photographing many of the items in our collection. So we've gotten a lot of things done, but all that is prologue to what we see as a future in which we can start doing some real museum style exhibits of the town's history. And any of you who wish to contribute to that process, please let us know. It's a pleasant transition, however, from trying to get all the ducks lined up to actually moving on to trying to do things with museum exhibits. I've had the privilege of being the Society's president since 2019, and I think it's time, it's a good transition point for me to move on and let somebody else take over that role. But I would like to say to you as the members and to the board members who are here, thank you very much for your support and your time and your effort and your energy, and I very much appreciate it. Thank you. The main business item today is to deal with the election of board members. So, Carol, if you would like to come up and take us through that process.
Thank you, Tom. Under the Society's old bylaws, the Board of Directors consisted of 12 directors plus 4 officers, for a total of 16 members of the board. The Society's new bylaws requires that the officers will be elected from among the members of the board. So no longer are the officers will the officers be elected by the membership. The nominating committee are proposing the addition of 2 directors to the 12 slots that existed under the old bylaws for a total of 14 board members. In order to stagger the terms of the new directors, the nominating committee recommends increasing by 1 the number of directors that serve until 2024. The nominee is Richard Rosen. Increasing by 1 the number of directors that serve until 2025. The nominee is Emily Wade, or Patty as most of us know her. Filling a vacant director position that would serve until 2026. The nominee is Tom Kinzer. And finally, the nominating committee recommends the following 3 to serve through 2027, a full 4-year term: William Moonen, Paul Percha, and Jan Van Steenwyck. Are there any nominations from the floor? Is there a motion that the clerk cast 1 ballot for the entire slate as presented? Thank you, Jan. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? You wouldn't dare. The ayes have it. The slate of directors is approved unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Is there any other business to be brought before this meeting? Seeing none, then I suggest that we simply adjourn the business part of this meeting and get on with the good stuff, which is the presentation by Sharon McDonald on delightful Bedford characters from the past. Sharon, it's all yours.
Well, as I look down upon you, it's a delight to see you on this pretty afternoon. I've been thinking all weekend. I have 3 characters that I want to tell you about, and I've been thinking all weekend, which one shall I start with? Benjamin Simons, Dr. Emmanuel Pfeiffer, or Lucinda Hosmer? And I thought, oh, Lucinda Hosmer is such a nice, cozy person. I think I'll start with her. First of all, the years 1810 to 1820 are an underrated decade. Napoleon and the Duke of Wellington were fighting. Beethoven wasn't deaf yet. Jane Austen was writing Pride and Prejudice. The brothers Grimm were wandering through Germany listening to old people tell stories. Henry Thoreau, Florence Nightingale, Karl Marx, Louis Pasteur, Phineas T. Barnum, Gregor Mendel, and Harriet Tubman are gathering themselves to be born. George Stephenson is tinkering with his steam locomotive, and Silas Thorla and Robert McGee have dug the first oil well by mistake, and they filled it up again. Back home, let's see if you remember, in 1810, 1820, how many states did we have? 24 is good, a little fewer. 20, you're getting there. There were 18 states, 18 states. And who was president?
Jackson.
You got the right initial, James Madison. Now, Francis Scott Key was about to compose new words to the song "To Anacreon in Heaven," and such song was entitled, "The Star-Spangled Banner." The U.S. had declared war on Britain. One July night, Dolly Madison had to flee the White House because the British had set it afire. And now come back to Bedford. In Bedford, the population, 1810, how many? 600, Nathaniel Page, who oral history says, carried a brilliant crimson flag to the battles on April 19, 1775, still living? Yes. And his youngest daughter had just ripped the fringe off the flag. There was still only one church in town, the Church of Christ in Bedford. The Trinitarians and the Unitarians had not yet parted company. The big hurricane of 1815 was about to blow down enough trees to build a new church building, the one you see on the common now. But to Lucinda Hosmer. She was born in Bedford in that decade, 1814 to be precise. Her name was Lucinda Hosmer, and at the time her mother, Ruth, was keeping house while raising 10 children. I won't name them. And her father, Castillo, was serving in the War of 1812 as an army lieutenant. When he was at home, he was a cordwainer. What's a cordwainer?
A shoemaker.
You need to know what cordwainers are, so hold that thought. The 19th century was an era of reform. There was plenty to be active about. Remember temperance, utopian societies. Four of Lucinda's siblings lived at Brook Farm for a while. Enslavement of African Americans, women's rights. Our Lucinda was an activist her whole life long. As a young woman, Lucinda was a fervent abolitionist. In Massachusetts, slavery, which had been quite legal here in Bedford in the 17th and 18th centuries, had ended with the ratifying of the state constitution in 1783. Yet it was widely accepted in many parts of the U.S. In 1793, the U.S. Senate had passed the first fugitive slave law, stating that any enslaved persons escaping their bondage would be caught and delivered back to their enslaver, and there was a stricter law to come. When she was 30, Lucinda became a member of the Massachusetts Anti-Slavery Society and the New England Anti-Slavery Society. She had a talent for writing, and she began to write long letters to William Lloyd Garrison's abolitionist newspaper, The Liberator. She closed one exclaiming, "I can say with you, Mr. Garrison, I am an abolitionist of not afraid." One of the efforts that Massachusetts abolitionists made was to ask the great orator and former slave, Frederick Douglass, to deliver 100 speeches through the state. And one of his engagements was in Bedford. Frederick Douglass came to Bedford. He gave lectures for 2 days, and it didn't go well. He said in his diary nothing about Bedford, But he said, "Now I'm going to Sudbury, and I hope it doesn't turn out as badly as Bedford did." So Lucinda was quite affected by his lecture. One day in the early 1840s, she and Ann Eliza Bacon, remember I talked about Ann Eliza Bacon, who went to Wisconsin? No, that was the last character. And Frederick Douglass invited them to have lunch with him at his house. Long after, she wrote to Douglass himself. The letter is included in his papers, and it addresses him as "My long-remembered friend. I was always anti-slavery since I thought of it at all, but never till I saw you did I feel it in my power to do anything about it." Abolition was not Lucinda's only cause. After the American Civil War, like many who'd been fierce abolitionists earlier, she turned to the struggle for women's rights. She continued to use her letter-writing skills. This time, she wrote many times to the Woman's Journal, a weekly national newspaper that was concerned with women's legal, educational, and voting rights. A full run of that newspaper still exists, and, to delight a librarian's heart, is indexed. I was able to read what was happening down in Bedford. Homer described a society of Bedford women who met in each other's parlors for afternoon discussion of the issues. Grape juice, not sherry, was the beverage. Temperance was an issue they felt strongly about. Attendance grew and threatened to outgrow most ladies' parlors. The group included prominent women, the Bacons, the Webbers, the Unitarian minister's wife, Eulalia Fairfield. Three men became members, the doctor, the newspaper editor, A.E. Brown, and Lucinda's influential cousin, Jerome. So the programs would open with musical entertainment, violin, piano, or trumpet. How big a parlor would you have a trumpet prelude? And then several would read papers that they had written on suffrage. Sometimes they held programs in the great room of the town hall, this room, hearing speakers from all over Massachusetts. The State Woman's Rights League, the State Woman's Rights League met here in 1883. Soon the Bedford Woman Suffrage League were doing more than playing the piano and reading papers. Under Lucinda's urging, they sent petitions to the state senate asking that women be granted their right to vote. Bedford's population had not reached 1,000, but Lucinda single-handedly got almost 100 signatures on every petition, and she gathered over the years 13 petitions. I think it is a good idea to flood them with the reasons women have for desiring the ballot, that they can no longer say women do not want to vote. In 1879, the state legislature gave women a pittance. They were allowed to vote, but only for the school committee. To vote in Bedford, of course, a woman had to go to the town meeting. Bedford town meeting must have been a bit rowdy in those times. The men stood around, hats on, and smoking and spitting. But that first year, Ms. Hosmer and 10 other women did go and found that the men had cleaned up their acts. They were sitting politely in their seats, their hats were off, and there was no spitting or smoking. Well, one man tried to smoke, but they stopped him. When she passed out the ballots, Lucinda said it was like she was passing out ice cream. I'm going to sneeze. I'm not going to sneeze. Hosmer was sorry she couldn't have voted for abolition all those years ago. In her opinion, the Civil War might have been fought and won with ballots instead of bullets if the women had had the vote. Now the issue was temperance. At this town meeting, the men could have made selling liquor in Bedford illegal, but they let it pass. And the Bedford House, the big hotel in the center of Bedford, continued to cater to drinkers. The suffragists insisted that a woman wielding the ballot would have been a force for the general good and not just for temperance. The anti-suffrage groups included women who later coalesced under the catchy name The Massachusetts Association Opposed to the Further Extension of Suffrage to Women. Isn't that catchy? The Massachusetts Association Opposed to the Further Extension of Suffrage to Women. And for them, women's rights were promoting free love, birth control, socialism, college education, and the labor movement. And they were adamant against them. But Lucinda was clear that the women's rights campaign was not for loosing a nation of wild women or for making war on men. The point of suffrage was women adding their weight to solve the problems of the day, the issues of the day. Lucinda Hosmer did not live to see the passing of the 21st Amendment. She and her sister Anna had kept house together on South Road, just a few doors down. They moved to Washington, D.C. to take care of their brother, and there she died in 1902. Truth crushed, will rise, was a motto she loved and had lived by, and she made a difference in 19th century Bedford. Don't you wish you could go back in time and have lunch with her? All right, that's Lucinda. I just know I'm going to drop all these. Here we go. Now, this is Dr. Emmanuel Pfeiffer, Sr. Unlike the other Bedfordians we will talk about today, Dr. Emmanuel Pfeiffer was not born in Bedford. He was born in Denmark and immigrated to America about 1870. He and his family moved about New York, New Jersey, Boston, and in 1892, they bought a large farm in Bedford. The Pfeiffers called the farm Orchard Farm. It covered 40 acres, and it was from the corner of Brooksby. You know, 62 goes off toward Burlington. That's Brooksby. The corner of Brooksby, and the house is still there, along Brooksley Road all the way to Page Road, which is where Wedgwood is. That whole area was Orchard Farm. That was Pfeiffer's farm. At first, Dr. Pfeiffer had a practice in Boston, but in the 1900 census, while Olive and the children were still in Bedford, Emmanuel disappears. Disappears from the census, that is. I found him in the North Adams, Massachusetts newspaper. He was making quite a splash in North Adams. He had opened a medical practice advertising he could cure everything from tumors and morphine addiction to freckles. Really. From 1898, the paper was full of articles by him, about him, testimonials to him as well. He explained that he was a doctor of last resort. He only took on patients that other doctors had given up on. He did not believe in medical science. He used the natural method of letting the body cure itself, and this was accomplished through fasting. He fasted himself, only drinking water, for 21 days in 1900 and for 30 days in 1901. How did he open a practice in North Adams, which is out by the New York border, when he was living in Bedford? Well, this is my own detective work, but I believe that for several years, he went to North Adams to stay with his son, William, who was living there, for a few days during the week, and then would come back to Bedford, to the rest of the family, who were staying in Bedford. Other days, let me see. He returned to Bedford to live full-time about 1902. Now, Pfeiffer was a crusader. He was a licensed physician, but he went up against the Massachusetts Medical Board intent on changing the licensing rules to include hypnotists, clairvoyants, magnetic healers, and Christian scientists. His campaign, anybody who wants should be able to be a doctor. The crusade he is most famous for is his attack on smallpox vaccine. In 1901, smallpox was raging in Boston, and doctors were going house to house, vaccinating everyone they could. Pfeiffer was outraged and insisted that human beings had the right to choose for themselves whether or not vaccine was poison. The argument escalated. It was picked up by the newspapers. Dr. Samuel Durgin, chair of the Boston Board of Health Commission, openly dared any anti-vaxxer to visit the smallpox hospital on Gallops Island in Boston Harbor. Pfeiffer took the dare. In January of 1902, he went to Gallops Island, toured the hospital, met the patients, and even deliberately breathed in one patient's breath. Well, the Board of Health assigned a police officer to follow him home, but he evaded them. He stayed in Boston for a few days and then returned to Bedford by public transportation. In 13 days, it was obvious that he had indeed come down with smallpox, and the newspapers feasted on it. Tracking Pfeiffer. Dr. Pfeiffer may die of smallpox. Pfeiffer yet alive. He is better. But that did not prove him wrong. He proved to himself that his methods, particularly fasting, but not vaccine, kept him from dying from that deadly disease. And Bedford was furious. His daughter had continued to attend school and could well have spread the disease. Pfeiffer appears in the town reports of 1902 and 1903, you know, town reports. First, the selectman's report. Just at the close of the best financial year the town has had in a long time, we are now startled by the appearance of a case of smallpox brought among us, as it appears at this time, through the foolhardiness of one of our citizens. He, feeling he was immune to the disease, went voluntarily among it. Now he is suffering from a very bad case of it. The townspeople are surprised that he should come home and expose the members of his family, as he must have known he had contracted the disease and should have gone to the hospital for treatment. The Board of Health, realizing that prompt action must be taken, appointed a number of special police officers to guard the premises and see that the orders of the board were enforced. The board voted that, in their opinion, it would be for the best interest of the town that orders be given compelling vaccination in the town. In the next year's Board of Health report, it was stated that just one case of smallpox had been reported. This would be Pfeiffer's. But the cost of the vaccinations and the special police cost the town $1,034.01. No one in his family caught it. No one in Bedford caught it, because of the vaccine or because of Dr. Pfeiffer's health regimen. In our own times, the question continues to stir furious response. And this, Dr. Emmanuel Pfeiffer, was brought to my attention by John Gibbons, who knows all kind of cool stuff. You ready for another one? Wait a minute. The pollen. Tell me, what is a cordwainer? Have you forgotten? Shoemaker. And what is the difference between a cordwainer and a cobbler? Exactly. A cobbler repairs shoes, and a cordwainer makes new shoes. Now, how many men and women were working in the shoe industry in Bedford in the 1830s? 140 people. At the time, the population was 675, so like 150 out of 700. That's a lot of people. You're going to be glad you know this in a minute. Let me say before I begin that I am grateful to Kara Kerwin, who introduced me to Benjamin Simons and gave me her notes on his life. Generous gift, thank you. Do you know Kerwin, sitting in the back? Yes, yes, she's great. Benjamin Simons was born and grew up in Woburn. In 1805, at the age of 21, he moved to Bedford with his parents and five younger brothers and sisters. Now, most Bedford families at that time were farmers, but the Simons were cordwainers. They settled in the south part of Bedford near the local tannery where leather was easy to come by. Now, in early colonial times in Massachusetts, many householders owned their own cordwaiting tools and made the boots and shoes their families required. Later, the craft was taken over by itinerant cordwainers who went from house to house making shoes. Then the craftsmen began to settle down and open workshops. The customers would bring leather to them and order their shoes. But with the coming of the Simons and others, Bedford began an industry of shoemaking, that is, making shoes for Bedfordians, but also making enough extra to sell in Boston. Now, Bedford's specialty was high-end ladies and children's shoes. They were all handmade. The sewing machine hadn't been invented yet, and very much in demand. Seeing the opportunities, men and women came from as far away as Vermont and New Hampshire to live and work here. Women worked from home, cutting and sewing the leather uppers, and the men worked in the shops, pulling the leather over the last and sewing the upper to the sole. You will have heard that they made the left shoe and the right shoe identical, and that's true. But you know, Carol Hand and I know, that when you, you know Carol Hand right here? When you wear your leather shoes for a little while, especially in damp weather, they conform to your feet. So you do have a left shoe and a right shoe. You're welcome. Little sheds began to appear attached beside or behind or in front of houses, and they often measured 10 feet by 10 feet. They were called 10 by 10s. About the only one left for us to see is the back L of the Congregational Parsonage. This was Lewis Gleason's shop. Most 10 by 10s were in the center of town, though some cordwainers' workshops were a mile or two from the center, like the Simons. Now Bedford was acquiring retail stores, taverns, and a hotel where the stagecoach between Concord, New Hampshire, and Boston stopped. The busy center of town was not the common or the church, but around the intersection of the main road and the road to Concord, about where Bedford Farms is now. That was the center of town. Bedford shoes were getting a fine reputation. Lemuel Shattuck, the Concord historian, wrote in his History of Concord that no shoes were in better credit than those made in Bedford. It's not exaggerating to say that it was an industry. Shattuck says that one year, 90,000 pairs of shoes were made in Bedford. 90,000 pairs of shoes. I'll interrupt myself to remark here that the boom years in the Bedford shoe industry were the 1830s, after Benjamin Simon's time. That was when immigrants were pouring into the town. And by immigrants, I don't mean people from other countries, but those people from faraway Vermont and New Hampshire. And then by the end of the Civil War, the shoe industry was over. The country was in a depression. The sewing machine had been invented. The fine but expensive handmade shoes from Bedford weren't in demand. And the big shoemaking centers were now Lynn, Haverhill, Stoneham. But back to the 1820s. In that decade, Simons was a person of high prestige in town. He was a member of the church, a difficult thing to achieve, which involved publicly confessing his sins and relating his conversion experience, and then being voted on by the members. He was appointed auditor of the Middlesex Bible Society. Clean living. He served in several positions in town government, including moderator of town meeting. And in 1827, when the town meeting was considering buying some firefighting equipment, it was he who was appointed to go to Boston for 2 days to investigate the price and the efficiency of a pumper. At his suggestion, the town purchased that pumper, and you can see it today, proudly named the Eagle, in the Reed Room of the Town Hall. Have you been over there to see that funny look? Yeah, that's the Eagle. They also got some hose, some additional fire buckets, and they built an engine house to keep it all in, all for $536. Simon sometimes taught in the district schools. He was wealthy enough to purchase the old South Schoolhouse when it was replaced and have it moved to what is now the corner of Elm Street and Maple. Now you know that Elm Street and Maple kind of go around the common, and that house that was on the corner there, it's been replaced with a new house, was the old South Meeting House, South Schoolhouse. He was a bit of a wheeler dealer. He bought pews in the new meeting house and then sold them at a profit. He once bought two for $113 and sold one of them for $100. In the burying ground, there were two tombs which had sat among the gravestones for many years. And in 1826, Benjamin got the idea of building more and putting them up for sale. He bought a strip of land along the northern edge from Mrs. Hannah Reed and advertised for a stonemason to build a dozen tombs. They were done within a few months and ready for sale. Samuel Sage bought one, and Eliezer Davis, and Amos Hartwell. And then something terrible happened. We don't know what. The town records don't reveal it, and A.E. Brown's history doesn't either. But all of Benjamin Simon's business ventures failed. And overnight, he was hopelessly in debt. The Historical Society has a letter he wrote to Samuel Sage to tell him, register your new tomb quickly, because it might be repossessed by my creditors. Desperate to evade debtor's prison, he disappeared, leaving his wife, Elizabeth, and his five children, aged 5 to 16, behind, without a roof to live under. How did they manage? I don't know. Elizabeth's father-in-law, Benjamin Sr., had already passed away. Her brother-in-law, Zebedee, who might have helped, had died the year before. Elizabeth had family in Leominster, and perhaps the children went to live with an aunt and uncle, but there's no record of them there. Elizabeth herself soon died and is probably buried in one of those tombs in the old burying ground. Justin, the youngest son, remained in Bedford with a guardian, and later the girls all married. I hope they found loving places. Some information about Benjamin's life after he left Bedford comes from Benjamin himself. In 1835, he wrote his nephew a letter, and we have it in the Historical Society archives. He said, I'm living in Clarksville, Missouri. I still have no money. At one point, I had to sell some of my clothing to get enough money to eat. He had tried to get a job teaching school, but had become so terribly ill, he lost 40 pounds. He had to resign, but was hopeful of another teaching job. Although he longed to see his family, he knew that he could never go home again. He suggested that his 10-year-old son, Justin, come out to Missouri to live with him. The idea was moot. Benjamin died the next year. And his story has an odd twist at the end. Here was a man so hopelessly in debt that he was on the verge of being arrested and put into debtor's prison and had to flee the state. Yet after his death, his body was shipped back to Bedford, and he was buried in the old burying ground in tomb number 5. Who ordered this? Who paid for it? And why? Another mystery in the story of Benjamin Simons. And I thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for that, Sharon. Another wonderful view of some of our predecessors in this town. And with that, I believe we've come to the end of our meeting today. So thank you for coming. I very much appreciate your support. If any of you wish to volunteer to help us with anything, please feel free to do so. And we are adjourned. Thank you.